Good morning, and a very warm welcome to our worship from home. Today marks the final Sunday in Lent, and it's been a year since we started our services from home, and look at how we've evolved in that time. One thing that hasn't changed is that the last Sunday of the month is our family service, and the chance for our younger members to share with us on our theme of darkness before the dawn. Just before we hand over to them and David, I have a couple of notices to share with you. A couple of weeks ago, I told you about our friend Linda, who was in hospital. Well, I've been informed that she's now back home and recuperating there. We thank God that she's recovered enough to be allowed out of hospital, and we pray that she will continue to feel better every day. Also a few weeks ago, I told you about a prayer pack to help those of you that wanted to pray for the town centre mission. Macaulay would like to collect in your responses to the contents of the pack and find out whether or not it's been useful. There's a survey that you're requested to complete, and I know from experience that it only takes a couple of minutes to fill in. You can find details from Macaulay or Barry. This week is your final chance to join in with one of the Lent courses. Wednesday afternoon or evening with Reverend Tom, Reverend Amanda, or the circuit course is being run by Macaulay. You would be most welcome. As this is the beginning of Holy Week leading to Easter, reflections from the President and Vice President will be available each day from tomorrow to next Sunday, the 4th of April. You can watch them on the President and Vice President Facebook page on the Methodist Church Facebook page or on YouTube each morning. Finally, a quick reminder about litter picking on Good Friday. Meet up at the Ivanhoe for instructions at about 10 o'clock and you'll be required for a couple of hours. Now, before we welcome our younger members and David, shall we take a moment to ready ourselves? Let's share in a time of quiet. Still our minds, O God, and focus our hearts on you. Open us up that the words we say and hear, the songs we sing and listen to, the prayer we share together, may enable us to encounter your Spirit again today. Amen.
Make way, for Christ the King in splendour arrives. This is SMC at Home, welcoming you to worship as we join our hosannas with those of the first crowd on that first Palm Sunday. And yet, as we enter Holy Week, we remember that it is always darkest before the dawn.
Make way, make way!
Make way, make way!
For the King of Kings!
For the King of Kings!
Make way, make way!
Make way, make way!
For the King of Kings!
For the King of Kings!
Make way, make way for Christ the King, in splendor arise! Fling wide the gates and welcome him into
to heal the prisoners to Today we celebrate the triumphal entry of a king into Jerusalem. A king the like of which we have never seen before, a king riding a donkey. A king put to death in our place and raised up so we may have eternal life. A king who knows each of us by name and loves us beyond all understanding. Lord Jesus, we come before you in humility, to offer our praise and ourselves to your service. May we grow closer to you, know more of you, and to learn to follow in your footsteps. Amen.
Two people, moving and marching, thinking, head scratching about something big that's just been happening. But on the road to Emmaus from Jerusalem way, two became three as another says, hey, says he, you've been thinking and head scratching. Has something big just been happening? You've not heard about what's been happening? All of Jerusalem have been head scratching. What have I missed? Asks the man. I'd love to know. Please tell if you can. It's about a man called Jesus, and we thought he was coming to rescue God's people and send the Romans off running. He did, and he said loads of cool stuff from a place up north called Nazareth. He told great stories and healed the sick. He knew people by name and what made them tick. Oh, remember that wedding? He turned water to wine, brought his friend back to life, and his friend felt just fine. He was sharing and caring, just ask his friend Pete. He walked on the water with only his feet. He said shush to the storm and the storm was hushed. He did a miracle with bread and thousands were stuffed. Besides all this, his sermon up a hill had so many stories, super cool and brill. I can't believe it. What a big loss. A man so great who hung on a cross, and on that cross, that's where he died. I feel so tied up in knots inside. And 3 days have passed, though it feels more like 70, because now we've heard that his tomb is empty. That's right, you heard me. His body is gone. But who'd take his body? He never did wrong. You seem confused and out of the picture. So let me show you what it says in the scripture. It was always the plan, right from the start, because Jesus loved you with all of his heart. He died on the cross, but rose from the tomb. He came back to life so you can live too. And as they were moving, and still head scratching, two of them stopped, but the third kept on marching. Don't go, please, the two say. The sun's gone to bed, so why don't you stay? Good point, says the third. Day has turned to night. I'll stop over with you two and then grab a bite. And as they sit down to eat, they close their eyes. He thanks God for the grub, then what a surprise! The two people stare and then rub their eyes. It's Jesus, not gone, but fully alive! And before they say seconds, there's more bread going round. Jesus just vanishes. He cannot be found. The two are left thinking, I'm really head scratching. They'd just been with Jesus. Something big was happening. We must say we've seen Jesus, so tie up your shoes. Quick, to Jerusalem, there's no time to lose. All along it was Jesus, the very same one. They were searching the scriptures with God's precious son. It's the biggest story that's ever been told. About Jesus who's risen, it never gets old. The two met with Jesus in the most surprising way. They shared the story, and we still share it today.
Praises rising. Eyes are turning to you. We turn to you. Hope is stirring. Hearts are yearning for you. We long for you. When we see you, we find strength to face the day. And in your presence, all our fears are washed away, washed away.
This is the season of Lent, when we prepare for the coming of Easter. When we prepare to enter Jerusalem. Jerusalem. But who will show us the way? Jesus will show us the way. Here he is on his donkey, preparing to enter Jerusalem, along with his disciples. But people gathered along the way. The whole road was filled with people. They brought with them cloaks which they lay in his path. And they shouted, "Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord." And they took palm branches and shouted, "Hosanna! Hosanna to the highest! Hosanna! Hosanna to the highest! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord." I wonder why the people wanted Jesus to be their king. I wonder who they were who shouted by the side of the road, "Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord." I wonder why he rode a donkey. I wonder what kind of king Jesus would be. I wonder what it'd be like to be a part of his kingdom.
We have a king who rides a donkey. We have a king who rides a donkey. We have a king who rides a donkey.
Jesus, when we don't follow your instructions, we're sorry, forgive us. When we don't celebrate our love for you enough, we're sorry, forgive us. When we don't look after each other as you did, we're sorry, forgive us. When we are not generous enough with that we have, we're sorry, forgive us. Amen.
The earth is awakening, the mountain. nations hold their breath for this holy moment. The heavens stand to their feet as life like a river springs up from a thirsty land. Collision of God and
we take for granted, like beds, houses, education and warm clothes.
For frontline staff who continue to work for others throughout this crisis.
I would like to pray that the virus will soon be gone and that everyone is kept safe.
Please, you can help.
Please look after my friends,
all my friends
and my family.
I would like to thank everyone for all the wonderful donations to Baby Basics. And I would like to pray for each baby and their families who have received a basket.
Watch all over all the children without a mummy and daddy and make them feel safe. Amen.
God, please help people who are poorly and help everyone get the vaccine. Amen.
Dear God, please make sure all people have a warm, safe, cozy house. Amen.
A reading for this Palm Sunday is taken from the Gospel according to Mark, chapter 11, and reading verses 1 to 11.
The story of Easter, the triumphal entry. This is Jesus.
Heyo!
Who is the Son of God and the Savior of the world. While Jesus was on earth, he taught everyone about God's love and healed people from their sickness. He did many miracles like calming storms and even raised people from the dead.
Wahoo!
At this time, the Jewish people were celebrating a festival called Passover that had been celebrated since the time of Moses when God brought his people out of Egypt. So Jesus was going to Jerusalem to celebrate. Jesus and his disciples stopped in a town.
You coming?
And Jesus told two of his disciples to go on ahead of them.
Okay.
He told them to go into a village and that they would see a young donkey that no one had ever ridden.
Rock!
He told them to untie it and bring it to him. If anyone asks, what are you doing? He told them to just say, the Lord needs it, and we'll return it soon.
Yeah, okay, go ahead.
So the disciples did what Jesus said and brought him the donkey. A long time ago, before Jesus was even born, God had said that the Savior, the King of Israel, would come to Israel in this way. And now Jesus was doing just as God had said. The news that Jesus was coming to Jerusalem swept through the city. Many heard about all the amazing things he had done, so they cut palm branches and ran to see him.
Huh?
The Pharisees and religious rulers realized that there was nothing they could do, for everyone was going to see Jesus. Jesus rode into the city of Jerusalem, and the crowd spread their coats on the road ahead of him. His followers began to shout and sing as they walked along, praising God for all the wonderful miracles they had seen. The Pharisees were upset.
Hey, Jesus!
And they told Jesus to stop the people from saying things like that. But Jesus said, if they keep quiet, the stones along the road would burst into cheers. So the people kept on singing, blessings on the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Praise God in highest heaven. The entire city of Jerusalem was in an uproar as he entered, asking, who is this? And the crowds replied, it's Jesus. And Jesus rode the donkey through the street of Jerusalem to the temple in a triumphal entry, just as God said he would many years before.
Jesus and his disciples were approaching Jerusalem at Bethphage and Bethany near the Mount Olives. They were almost near enough to hear the noise of pilgrim crowds in the city. Jesus sent two of his disciples on ahead and they went, his surprising words echoing in their minds. He had said, go into the next village, and as soon as you enter it, You will find tied up a colt that has never been ridden, and tie it and bring it to me. If anyone asks what you are doing, just say, the Lord needs it, and will bring it back here immediately. So they went off and found a colt in the street, tied up near a door. As they were untying it, some of the bystanders said to them, what are you doing untying the colt? They told them what Jesus had said, and they allowed them to take it. Then the disciples brought the colt to Jesus, threw their cloaks on it, and he sat down on the animal. There was a crowd of people, and many of them spread their cloaks out on the road in front of Jesus, while others laid down leafy branches that had been cut from the fields. And these pilgrims sang the ancient songs, Hosanna, blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the coming kingdom of our ancestor David. Hosanna, the highest heaven. And in these words, they heard the cries of the prophets of old. Then Jesus entered Jerusalem and went into the temple. He looked around at everything, and as it was late, they went to spend the night at Bethany with his 12 disciples.
We have been focusing on the theme of the darkness before the dawn during this period of Lent. The story makes me think that this event itself is a dawning before the darkness of the dawn. It reminds us that this triumphal entry into Jerusalem precedes the dark events of Good Friday before the eventual triumphs of Easter Sunday. Why do I think it's a dawning moment? What are some of the things we could reflect upon with regard to this event that makes it a dawning moment? Do you notice that it's all done with planning and intent? Notice the prearranged borrowing of a donkey, which had all the elements of a secret mission with a planned password. For when challenged, they were to say, the Lord needs it. How did the crowd know that he was going to make this kind of entrance? How did they know he was coming? Because they seemed prepared for the event, stripping branches from trees and having cloaks at the ready. Who had told them what was about to happen? But perhaps only one person really knew what was being planned and the ultimate destination of his journey. Yes, it was to be a triumphal entry into the city of Jerusalem, but we know it was in reality a journey to the cross. And so did Jesus. Perhaps it didn't dawn upon the disciples that this was Christ's intent, but they seemed to know that something special was about to happen. Then there was the reception that Jesus received that really was something special. I always remember that story of Sir Walter Raleigh spreading his cloak over a puddle for Queen Elizabeth. I doubt if it was true, but it did reflect that notion of respect and commitment to the monarch. Here there are cloaks and branches. Mark just has branches, but John talks about palms. This entry was all accompanied by shouts and cries as people lined the way. It reminded me of when I was young and the Queen visited Doncaster for the races, or the time when the Queen came to Sheffield University to give out Maundy money, and huge crowds lined the route and all the traffic came to a halt. To the crowd here was someone special. They had watched his progress and heard all about his miracles of healing and the wonderful thought-provoking words he had to say. As Godly Play puts it, there was once someone who did such wonderful things and said such amazing things that people followed him. Perhaps they'd been fortunate enough to listen to the message, or at least heard that message passed on by others. Here was someone very special, and they wanted to tell everyone that they'd been there on that day. Then there was the notions of kings and kingdoms. Perhaps some had come expecting Jesus to be the Messiah, who would dispel the Roman rulers. If so, they would have been rather disappointed, especially by the mode of transport. Can you imagine the Queen arriving at Sheffield Cathedral on the back of a donkey? Did they get the message from the transport? For a donkey was a symbol of peace, not war and violence. I think there would have been some who would want to incite the mob to violence, but this very action by Jesus put a stop to it. Remember, this was the time of Passover, when the people of Israel remembered their escape to freedom from a tyrannical ruler. Not Caesar, but Pharaoh. But the symbol was there for all to reflect upon. Did it dawn upon them that what he was doing was expressing a kind of kingdom, a kingdom of love and humility, a kingdom in the messianic tradition, which was expressed in the words of the prophets, where justice would flow like a never-ending stream? This thought about a heavenly, God-inspired kingdom is reflected in the words they shouted. Again, there's a notion of kings and kingdom, but here it's more of an emphasis of one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the King of Israel. Blessed is the coming kingdom of our father David. Hosanna in the highest heaven. Yes, Jesus made it very clear in all his teaching that this was a very different kind of kingdom. But had they really heard the message? With this triumphal entry, everything seems set for a glorious conclusion to his ministry. But then comes the darkness before the dawn. They meet in secret in an upper room to celebrate the Passover. And there are rumours of betrayal. There is a dark moment in a garden when trusted disciples fall asleep. There is the kiss of betrayal. There is the sound of denial. There is the dispersal of disciples. There is torture and ill treatment. There are brutal words and evil actions. There's a cross and the shame it would bring. There is darkness across the whole world. Is this the end of it all? Where are the cheering crowds? Have they become a baying mob? When Jesus told the story of the sower and the seed, he reflected how easily people could forget the message of hope and love. He knew from the stories he told and the actions he undertook just how easily people could condemn others, to seek to pluck the speck from their neighbour's eye rather than the log within their own. How easy it is to follow the mob, to be ready with their stones to mete out punishment. How much harder, but how much more rewarding, to love and forgive. With that gentle hint that a life can change and be changed, in the words, go and sin no more. Would the seed really die in the darkness of the earth? Would all these dawning moments of realisation end in extinction? Well, we know differently, don't we? For we know the story of the resurrection. We know there is a dawn. So what did those disciples learn from the dawning before the darkness, before the dawn? Well, they learnt that life is a journey, sometimes carefully planned, sometimes an adventure into the unknown. They nearly all went on journeys, spreading the gospel message, spreading the stories of love and hope and a resurrection dawn. Sometimes so great was their commitment to the cause, they came to a rather sticky end. Yet nothing could stop them as they told stories of a glorious kingdom, remembering all those stories that Jesus had told them. They helped people to realise the power of love, the power of forgiveness. They told them of the power of God's presence in their lives, They shouted their hosannas to the highest heavens. They rejoiced in the coming kingdom and in their resurrected Lord. They learnt to live in the power of God's Spirit and to recognise that even in the darkest of days, God was there with them, walking the journey to their own Jerusalem with them and through them. When I was head at Wadworth Primary School, we put on a performance of the musical The Man from Galilee. It made a lasting impression upon me. It's a simple piece. It tells the story of Jesus from Palm Sunday to Easter Day. It's narrated by Matthew, and just before the final song, he says, "And that's the end of my story. It's a story of suffering, pain and sacrifice. Yet out of this has become joy and hope. Hope for a better world, a better life." Here are the words of that final song, one that I've never forgotten. "And now my story's over, and yet it's just beginning. It tells about our Saviour and the brighter world he's bringing. And just before I leave you, I'll give you a reminder that if you are a seeker, you'll be a finder. Look towards tomorrow, face the future with a smile. Open up your heart and let the sun shine. Tell yourself that life is so worthwhile. Although there may be grey skies, he will drive the clouds away. Open up your heart and let the sun shine, and you will find a better day." Will we be ready to make that journey? Will we be the seeker that becomes the finder? Will we resist being swayed by the mob and continue to discover the light of love in our own lives that makes life so worthwhile? Will we ensure that although there may be grey skies, we will trust in this amazing King and in his kingdom? May our dawning be a lasting one across the time. So look towards tomorrow, face the future with a smile, open up your heart to the King of Kings and Lords of Lords, and let the sun shine in. May you have a dawning this Easter time that shows you that God of love and peace in our Lord and Saviour Jesus Christ. Amen.
Come on and celebrate his gift of love, we will celebrate the Son of God who loved us and gave us life. We'll shout your praise, O King. You give us joy nothing else can bring. We'll give to you our offering and celebration praise. Come on and celebrate, celebrate, celebrate and sing. Celebrate and sing.
Celebrate, celebrate.
celebrate His gift of love. We will celebrate the Son of God who loved us and gave us life. We'll shout your praise, O King. You give us joy nothing else can bring. We'll give to you our offering in celebration praise.
Through earth triumphantly ride on and reign in every heart alone. O Lord Jesus Christ. And now, may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all evermore. Amen.